So we have two guest lecturers, and we actually have written introductions, which is because they're fun. So Leandro Palacios is a guest lecturer here often. He's a tenor and former vice president of the Toronto Choral Society, with whom he has performed Handel's Messiah several times and will again next week at Kerner Hall. So it's an amazing venue here in Toronto, and if there's still seats available, so that's something certainly worth going. I haven't seen them perform the Messiah, but the Toronto Choral Society did a great job in the last Christmas performances there. He is also the music director here at Community of Christ Toronto Congregation every Sunday. He studied music at the National University of Rosario in Argentina and is an accomplished guitarist in addition to his talents as a singer. He points out that as a voice student in Rosario, he was never exposed to Handel's Messiah at all, because in Argentina, nobody would ever deign to sing classical music in English. So without further ado.
Welcome, everyone. I would like to just start today by giving you a brief outline of what's going to happen today. This, for those of you who have been here before, this is going to be a little bit different. We don't usually have, first of all, two people presenting, but also we don't usually have a lot of music in our presentations. In fact, I don't remember we've done any presentations on the topic of music in the past. So we're going to first start with Mike, who is going to be giving us the historical background of the composer, of Friedrich Handel, or whichever way is supposed to be pronounced. And then I think we're going to talk about that. After that, I will make a pause to consider the context, both at the time of the composition of this piece, 1741, what was happening in England, in London, what was happening in terms of what were the philosophical trends, what were the musical styles that people preferred, that were in the composers were experimenting with. And after that, knowing about the composer and the context, we will start diving into Messiah, seeing what the structure is and what is all the text, all this scripture, the libretto, that is all coming from primarily Old Testament, but also the New Testament. And so now, without further ado.
I didn't realize it was, I got to introduce Mike.
Oh, you have to introduce Mike, but before that, I'm going to give you just one quick laundry list of, well, it's just very simple. If you have a quick question, the presenter has to repeat the question before answering the question. And if it's a little bit more lengthy question or a comment, please raise your hand and Jefferson will bring the microphone to you so that the online participants on live Facebook stream can also hear you.
Okay, I should have probably introduced both at first, but this is what we'll do now. So Mike, who's our second presenter, Mike Karpowicz, is the pianist for the Community of Christ Toronto Congregation. And for the last 3 years, he's also been invited to perform at the annual Community of Christ Canada East Conference, and also provide music for all of our connection retreats that we do here in Ontario. Mike studied piano at Ball State University in Muncie, Indiana, where he worked as an accompanist for singers and instrumentalists and served as the pianist in the Ball State University Wind Ensemble. And he has served as a classical music announcer for WBST-FM, where he learned how to pronounce all the composers' names properly. Mike has very strong opinions about classical music, but he assured me that they are entirely justified. So without further ado, Mike.
Thanks, everyone, for coming. Thanks, everyone, who's joining us online. I want to start with a couple questions. First, do we have any experts on Handel in the audience? Okay, good. So I don't have to ask anyone to leave. And the second, who has actually sung the entire thing? I assume Elizabeth has, Chuck has. So we have a couple people, Leandro has. And what was my third question? It'll come to me later. So, what I'm going to do, we're dividing this into two parts. I'm going to be talking about Handel's biography himself. So, let me get this going. Our lecture tonight is about the Messiah, which is one of the most beloved and widely known works of classical music. Virtually nobody who's grown up in our greater European cultural zone that we live in here would not recognize the Hallelujah Chorus. Very few classical pieces, among them Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, which is famous enough that they could make a straight-to-DVD release with its name, and Mozart's Eine kleine Nachtmusik. That's an editorial opinion right there. That would easily be, but these are just some of the few pieces that would easily be recognizable to the population. But while the dramatic lives and personalities of composers like Beethoven and Mozart have become the fodder for Hollywood films, and they're therefore well-known characters in the pantheon of Western cultural mythology, who knows anything about Handel the man or the story of his life? Yeah, but it's generally not very widespread that people know much about him. So, you know, we all live with the legacy of the kind of this romantic era paradigm of the artist as a fiercely independent and often tortured and emotionally unstable and sometimes tubercular or syphilitic, but brilliantly individualistic producers of these purified products of their white-hot souls. I mean, this is that's kind of what you think of as Beethoven, right? Or Mozart. And into this narrative that arose in the 19th century and that still infects our worldview today about artists and composers, Beethoven and Mozart fit very nicely, as do Chopin, Schumann, and some others. But when we view the world through this lens that we've inherited, it can be really difficult to bring the composers of the Baroque era into a satisfying focus. So Handel, as we see here, he wasn't tortured, he wasn't tempestuous, he wasn't tubercular. He was known as a steady, reliable, entrepreneurial workaholic who was known to his friends as a jovial dinner companion. And rather than always pushing the envelope and being a revolutionary, he imbibed the stylistic influences of his predecessors and contemporaries and perfected the craft of composing in the then current fashion. So he wasn't busy pushing the envelope, which we sort of assume that that's what an artist should do now. You should break new ground. That's what gives you cachet. So he was perfectly happy to continuously rewrite his own music. That doesn't sound that great. To meet the needs of the next performance, as well as to lift themes or even whole movements from other composers unattributed in order to fill out a score. So he got the job done. And to be sure, he was recognized in his day as one of the best composers in Europe. But with his even-tempered, utilitarian approach to his work, he comes off as kind of an unsatisfying figure to us today with our sense that, you know, artists should be melodramatic and tempestuous like Beethoven. And I think that's one of the reasons why we popularly don't really know that much about Handel. So we're going to start tonight with an overview of his life, and so we can better understand where the Messiah fits into the wider context of his life and career. So we're going to do just kind of a quick overview of his biography, and then I'll turn it over to Leandro to get into the under the cover of the score itself. So the title of my portion of tonight's presentation is, in a nod to Handel's German background, is Handel in den Griff bekommen, which we can roughly translate into English as getting a handle on Handel. And Leandro referenced this earlier. You know, he has, originally in German, his name has an umlaut over the A, but in English, we don't have umlauts. And it's interesting to read through the primary sources from England at the time he was living there, because a lot of people, I mean, if you've ever read, like, 18th century English, it's people are very kind of fast and loose with spelling. And people routinely would spell his name H-E-N-D-E-L, which kind of indicates that they were pronouncing it in the German way, and nowadays we spell it with the A, without the umlaut, and a lot of people say Handel, and I actually can't even decide, so I will probably pronounce it both ways in the course of tonight. So, recovering the historical Handel, we don't know much about his early life. There weren't a lot of sources that survived. There's not a lot of writing in his own hand. He was not, there's not much commentary even from his peers on his character or personality. Now we get some of it when he becomes an adult, because he was such a big figure in London that people had, you know, he had his partisans, he had his people who were sort of competing against him, but generally he's, especially in his early life, because of his background, there's not that much that that we can, as historians, get into and find out about who he was as a person. And interestingly, he had no family as an adult to record or transmit his own history. So Handel never married. He, as far as the sources seem to indicate, he never seemed to have any interest in romance or children or anything. He was about his music. That's all he cared about. Singular focus. And his father, as we'll see, died when he was quite young, and he left Germany to go to England, and so he didn't really have much contact with his own family. So as a result, there's not even that much there. He doesn't have descendants who can try to lionize him in some way. So what we do know and can reconstruct about his childhood is that he was born February 23rd, 1685 in Halle, which is a city in kind of central, now eastern Germany. It's actually fairly close to where Johann Sebastian Bach was born just 1 month later in Eisenach. And so those are both areas in kind of the southwestern corner of the former East Germany. So his father at the time of his birth was 63 and his mother was 35. His father's first wife had died and he had married and started a new family. He had what at the time would be considered a middle class upbringing. His father was actually what they call a surgeon barber, which I hope none of you have one of those people in your professional network. But at the time, he was the surgeon barber to the Duke of Weissenfels. And so Germany, you've seen, if you've been to any of John's lectures, including last week, these maps of the Holy Roman Empire. So at the time, there were all these little tiny states with these little kind of petty nobility running the show, and the Duke of Weissenfels happened to be the one who was in his backyard. So he was connected to the nobility, although he wasn't one of them himself. And so Handel grew up as a musical prodigy in a non-musical family. This is a comparison like to Johann Sebastian Bach, who was born in a family where composition and being a musician was the trade. It was the family trade. I mean, he famously had 20 kids, and many of them became composers in their own right, and Bach's own parents and uncles were as well. So Handel sort of like sprung from nowhere because nobody else in his family showed any interest in music. And so as a result, his musical development as a child was really only reluctantly encouraged. His father wanted him to follow in the footsteps of the kind of the middle class aspirational track of going into the law. So he wanted him to stop playing that harpsichord and study your law books. That was his whole idea. But because of his father's connections with the local aristocracy, those people, they heard, I mean, however old he was, 6 or 7 year old Handel play a harpsichord, and the Duke of Weissenfels is like, wait a minute, you gotta give that guy some musical training. He's really, really gifted. And so his childhood is kind of like this tension between these two things. All he wanted to do, as was proved later in life, all he wanted to do was play and compose, but he had to satisfy his father's demands. So, coming of age, his father dies when he's 13. We know he was already quite old for the era. At the age of 17, keeping to his father's wishes, he enters the university in Halle to study law. But at the same time, he's hired as the organist for the cathedral on a 1-year contract because of somebody else having to leave in a hurry. And he also, if any of you have heard of Georg Philipp Telemann, he's a fairly well-known Baroque composer. He became friends with him around this age, and he lived in Leipzig, which was nearby, and gave Handel his first exposure to opera. And opera, I mean, because we think of Handel so much as being this composer of oratorios, it's easy to forget that his whole passion in life was Italian opera. And he only kind of reluctantly stopped composing operas and started getting into the oratorios, as we'll see a little bit later. So after 1 year of all this, he said, enough of that, I'm dropping out of school, I'm going to move to Hamburg and try my luck in the music business. So now we have young Handel. He's 18 years old, and he moves to Hamburg. And he was destined for success. This guy was obviously an extremely gifted musician. It was clear. He was very personable and agreeable. I mean, one of the things is that you read some of these references to how the only thing that he cared about was music and food. He had a voracious appetite. He just only focused on music, and there was nothing else. He never put anyone else down. He was very agreeable to be around. He was an effective networker, so he was very good, and where he learned the skill, it's unclear, but he was very good at ingratiating himself with the nobility, with local impresarios, and, you know, going into the biggest church in town and asking to play the organ and knocking their socks off. And so he was very good at getting a lot of support very quickly when he would move around. He was confident, he knew his skills, but he wasn't haughty. Like I said, he wasn't busy trying to squash other people on his way to the top. And he was extremely focused and hardworking. I mean, this guy, when you read, I mean, just a little preview here, he wrote the whole Messiah in 24 days. And he would write a whole opera in 7 days. And it's good. I mean, he's not just like using, like giving us the worst of his efforts. This is really good stuff he was able to turn out. And he wasn't one to shrink from a challenge, so he was willing to roll the dice and move to Hamburg as an 18-year-old with no support, no family, no nothing, no job, as he would do later in life. He would take these risks, and because of all these character traits that he had, it worked out really well for him. So why Hamburg? Hamburg was a large, wealthy Hanseatic city. So the Hanseatic cities were these kind of independent commercial cities on the north coast of Germany. And so what that meant is that as a port, it was exposed to a lot of ideas from overseas. And so a lot of the influences, the kind of artistic influences that wouldn't have penetrated all the way into the interior in places like Halle, where he was from, were, you know, people were coming and going, getting off boats. And so Italian opera was actually kind of first taking root in Germany in Hamburg at the time. The social and political power in the city was in the merchant class, and as we know, the aristocracy was, you know, merchant classes were rich, but they didn't have the same social status that like the landed aristocracy would have, and so therefore they made an extra effort to support local arts just to kind of elevate their own social status, and so that's who you had running the show in the city. He was able to operate in what we would now call the gig economy rather than have to, because of this, being in this merchant city, rather than having to become a patron of some ecclesiastical institution like a cathedral or aristocratic house like was so common throughout Germany. And at the time, like I was saying, it had the best opera scene in Germany. So he spent 3 years there, and as is so true with all of his early stuff, the sources are kind of sketchy. What we do know is that not long after getting there, he went to Lübeck to audition for the major church job. Buxtehude was a very prominent composer of the older generation who was ready to retire, and it's a funny story because he was capable and was offered the job, but the stipulation that Buxtehude said is that if you take this job, you have to marry my daughter. And so Handel was like, no, okay, so no Lübeck for him. In 1704, he joined an opera orchestra playing violin and harpsichord. And then in 1705, he actually premiered his first opera. So he... Sorry?
I think that's still performed.
Is it?
I think so.
7 weeks after his first opera, he premiered his second opera. So there you go. 18-year-old, or I guess at this point he was 20, so 20-year-old Handel. So I kind of consider this, just when you consider he went there when he was 18 and he left when he was 21, I guess. So it's kind of like his undergraduate musical education, unofficially. We'll kind of skip through this. Opera, there was really no German opera, it was Italian opera, and at this point. So, because Handel liked opera, and Handel was willing to take a risk, he left for Italy. So he made some connections, and actually, I think that the connection that got him to go was with the Medici family. So one of the prominent members of the Medici family from Florence happened to be in Hamburg. And because he was such a good networker, he got an invitation to come down there, which is pretty remarkable. So this kind of functioned as grad school, right? It was like from 22 to 26 is when he lived there, and he was like getting all the Italian kind of stylistic influences and all this experience. And his main base while he was in Italy was in Rome with a guy named the Marquess Ruspoli, who apparently was kind of a big deal. He spent his time in Rome composing works for the musicians in Ruspoli's household for holidays and special events. And at the same time, he had commissions from Naples, Siena, Florence, and Venice. So his name was getting out. Interestingly, a couple years before, the opera had been forbidden by the Pope in Rome. You know, at that time, the Pope ruled the papal territories, including Rome. And there had been some sort of scandal. You know, they were obviously not holy enough. But one thing that's interesting about that is that he was so into the opera, he found patrons to so that he could compose two operas, one which was premiered in Florence and one in Venice. So he made a really big splash in Venice. And because Venice was, if any of you were here for or heard John's lecture on Venice recently, it was like a center of diplomacy. Like all the diplomats from the world were kind of hovering around Venice because it was kind of the clearinghouse for intelligence and all that kind of thing. And so Venice was a great place for him to go in his kind of his job search. And he premiered this opera that he wrote. And there are all these guys from Northern Europe who are like, okay, my duke or my elector of Hanover or my king that I represent wants you. So he actually had, there was like a competitive bidding war for this guy. And the best offer was to join the court of the elector of Hanover, which is a major state in Northern Germany at the time. So he's appointed Kapellmeister to the court of Hanover. And so this was actually, in his whole life, his only really conventional kind of like musical patronage appointment like most other musicians, especially in Germany, would have taken, where you get kind of like attached to a royal family or a noble family or to a major cathedral or a church, and you spend the rest of your life and career there. And you're safe, you've got it, you know, you got the money, you got the stability you need. So it was kind of out of character for him to decide to do this, but somehow he was able to immediately negotiate a 12-month leave to travel. So good negotiator. And in November 1710, he turns up in London for the first time. So in early 1711, he writes and premieres a new opera. So this was the first one since the one he had done in Venice. It was his first show in London, and it was a smashing success. People were like, where have you been all our lives? Handel, we want you to stay. But he had to grudgingly return to Hanover in the fall of 1712 because, I mean, he just got this new job, they were paying him, and he had to go back.
Can I add something?
Yeah.
It sometimes was not only that you were taken care by your patron, but your patron did not want you to leave. And so Bach ended up in jail because he didn't have official permission to leave his patron. So it was an almost indenture servitude that some of these musicians ended up with. And once he moved to Leipzig, he was stuck there. He had to ask for permission to leave the city, which was a very tiny city.
And so this is the environment that Handel had grown up in, and he knew that this was the situation, right? So he wanted his freedom of movement, and he was able to negotiate that. So he spent a little bit of time back in Hanover, but he didn't really like it because, you know, this is like writing music for the corps, you know, for teaching the kids of the elector how to play the harpsichord, and you know, that wasn't, because there's opera, right? There are operas to write. There's really no opera for him in Hanover. So he goes back to London, composes two new operas before the end of 1712. He finds a new local patron, kind of a lower level guy in the nobility there to bankroll him. Was just granted a royal pension from Queen Anne in 1713, quite generous at the time. So again, this is a young guy who was like, didn't even live there yet. He was already well known and they were trying to keep him. And so he kind of tacitly abandoned his Hanover post, but without telling the elector or anyone. So he just kind of stayed in London, but he was lucky because Hanover came to London. Queen Anne died in 1714, and the nearest Protestant heir was none other than Georg Ludwig of Hanover. So there had been, because of all the wars with the English Civil War and the Catholics in the royal family, they had passed a law in England that forbade any Catholic to become the king or queen of England, and so or of the United Kingdom at that point. And so they had to go like way up the family tree and way back down, and they found this guy who just happened to be Handel's employer from Hanover. So he became King George I. And so he founded the Hanoverian dynasty that pretty much ruled until Victoria in England. No hard feelings. Can't stay mad at Handel. You know, he's a great guy, just went and had a beer and they were good. And in fact, he doubled the pension that Queen Anne had given him. And I should say these pensions were not, it was patronage, but it wasn't the kind of appointment that Leandro was talking about. They're like, you know, because we're the arbiters of good taste as the sovereigns or the nobility, we recognize your value, we'll pay you money, you do whatever you feel you have to do, because we know it'll be worth it. So in his early London years, again, kind of hazy historical records, he traveled twice back to Germany, in some ways, cases to see his family. In some cases because, if anyone knows the story of George I, he really didn't like being King of England. He never learned to speak English. He was kind of like, leave me in Hanover. So he would spend as much time as he could back in Germany, and of course, Handel sort of felt obliged to go back and hang out with him some of those times. And the initial opera scene in London at this point kind of fell apart. So he found a new patron and makes do writing kind of smaller scale works for these couple years. He's not really doing any opera because there are no opera companies in London. But this is one of the times where probably his most famous piece other than The Messiah, The Water Music. Does anyone know The Water Music? No one? Yeah. So he wrote that. This was a fairly early composition, and he did this. This was actually sort of like a publicity blitz that King George, who after being on the throne for a couple of years, he was like, wait, the English really don't like me, so I gotta like show some, like make some big extravaganza. So he like has this big royal barge in the Thames, and then they get another barge where they put 50 instrumentalists, and Handel writes all this music, and then they sail up the Thames, and everyone's like, oh, bravo, we love you, King George, now, I guess. So whether it worked, I'm not sure, but that was the idea. So this, what happened then in 1720 is a bunch of the local nobles and notables formed this Royal Academy of Music, which actually has no relationship to the current Royal Academy of Music. And what this really was just another attempt at a well-funded opera company. Now again, opera meant Italian here. So there was really no English language opera, just like there hadn't really been a German language opera in Germany at the time. So Handel travels to the continent. He's hired on right away to find Italian singers. He is appointed the master of the orchestra. So it's, again, it's sort of like a salary position, but it's very prominent. And he starts writing operas again. So this was a happy time for Handel. He finally got what he wanted, and he finds his stability and his success. He buys a house in Mayfair on Brook Street, I think it is. If you look at a map, it's like really, really, really expensive property now. So, and even then, it was like very close to where St. James's Palace was. So he did good. He garners consistent financial and moral support from the royal family, so not just from the king, but from the queen and from the Prince of Wales. So they're funding him in addition to the salary he's getting off these operas. And he writes and premieres an average of 3 new operas every season for this 8-year span. So because, like what we were saying, this guy could write a whole opera in 2 weeks, he was obviously also composing other things and doing other things as well. So because he had the favor of the royal family, he was composing, you know, church anthems for them, and if they had a special event or a birthday or a funeral, he was composing choral works or instrumental works for them as well. And he's basically recognized as possibly, even at that point, the leading light in the local London music scene. But there were problems in Paradise. Royal Academy was facing constant financial pressures because there was a competing opera company that had been set up, and the market for Italian opera in London in the 1720s was just not big enough. So they bled the patronage and kind of split the revenues and created this competition that didn't only exist in London, but also throughout Europe, this competition for the top Italian singers. People like Farinelli is probably the most famous one at the time. But you know, you were competing with the King of Spain and all these kinds of people that had unlimited resources for the top names. And so they had to shell out lots and lots of bucks to get these Italian singers. And because there was local competition, they really had to compete with each other for it too. And then there was, in England, or in London, a lot of competition from what they considered the lower forms of entertainment, like plays, burlesques, and satires. And part of the reason that these things were popular is because they were in English. You know, like regular people in London would go to an Italian opera and be like, okay, that's nice, what are they saying? But if you go to see, like, John Gay's The Beggar's Opera, which premiered in the 1720s, which is a huge hit. It's what the Threepenny Opera is based on.
Still performing.
And it's, you know, it's about, you know, common criminals and prostitutes and et cetera, et cetera. And this is not a very elevated topic, but it was very popular in London. So I think I went ahead here. Yeah, so there were problems. The Royal Academy collapsed in 1728. But Handel knew what he wanted. He was well established. He sticks with the Italian opera in spite of the fact that tastes were changing and that the whole opera scene was kind of falling apart. So he ended up taking more financial risk on himself rather than relying on a big pool of these donors to kind of fund the subscriptions and the company. He would make contracts with local impresarios and say, okay, I'm going to deliver in this season, I'm going to deliver the 3 operas, you're going to supply me with a house. They would sign a contract, and it's a lot of risk on him. And then the new opera of the nobility in 1733 took most of his best singers and supporters, and many of his supporters and subscribers. So again, there was a competing company, and so it was rough. By the time we reached 1737, at age 52, he had a stroke. Now, mind you, this is a guy who not only was composing, but he was performing. He would play the organ and the harpsichord for all of his performances. One of the things that he would do during his performances is when there was a break, he would just like get on the organ and start improvising. And he was phenomenal, right? So this was one of the big draws. And he lost the use of his right hand. So terrible, terrible moment for him. Takes a six-week cure at the spa in Aachen and miraculously recovers and returns to London. And apparently there's a story that the nuns at Aachen still consider this to be a miracle. And he gets right back into the opera business. So he had because of his whole background, he was mostly just interested in Italian opera. He didn't think English was really a language worth singing. And to be fair, even his own native German, he wasn't that interested in having anyone sing in German either. In 1718, during kind of this early period before the opera company had gotten started, he had composed this thing that was sort of like a proto-oratorio called Esther, and was able to find an occasion to revise and perform it in 1731. So that's his first oratorio in English. In 1738, he had his first collaboration with Charles Jennens on an oratorio called Saul. And Charles Jennens was the librettist for The Messiah. Strangely enough, I mean, it's kind of counterintuitive, but these oratorios in London proved more popular and commercially successful than... because they were in English, right? And they were also cheaper to produce because you didn't have the elaborate staging. So you just had, you had your choir, you had to pay your choir, you had to pay your musicians, but you could just do it in a regular theater. You didn't need all the whatever fireworks and things that you needed to have for an opera. And so I'm sure that Handel was just like kicking himself. Why didn't I think of this sooner?
17.
Yeah, Handel lived to 172 years old. No, so that should be a 1741. And in the same year that he wrote The Messiah, he wrote his last opera. So I unfortunately don't have at the top of my head how many total operas he wrote, but it's in the dozens. And he finally threw in the towel, and it's maybe kind of instructive that when he wrote what we all consider his greatest piece now, that was kind of like this pivot moment to his the high... later part of his career. So The Messiah, this is a quote: "The present day standing of Messiah makes it difficult for us to realize that for Handel its composition was an offbeat venture, unsure in its rewards and probably unrepeatable. It's the only truly sacred oratorio he ever wrote, and it was the only one performed during his lifetime in a consecrated building." Which is kind of interesting, right? Because again, you know, we think of, because the main piece that we know of Handel is this, you know, very religious oratorio, in fact, he was a very secular composer. He really only would compose religious works when required. That wasn't his thing. So this is Christopher Hogwood, who is a prominent, or was a prominent conductor who conducted a lot of Handel. So this librettist Charles Jennens, this was a guy from up in Leicestershire somewhere. He was, I think Leandro may say more about him. He wrote the libretto for The Messiah. He was kind of a cantankerous jerk. I mean, a lot of his letters survive, and it's great because you read these letters between him and his friend, and he's complaining, oh, Handel won't do anything I tell him to do. Oh, that Handel's the symphony at the beginning is too long, or sounds too French, right? And so it's like all this stuff, complain, complain, complain. But I guess he could get away with it because he was actually a really good librettist. He didn't only work on The Messiah, he worked on several other oratorios that Handel composed. So Handel got this invitation because things were kind of like not going so well for him in London. He got an invitation to spend the winter season in Dublin in this year. And he said, okay, why not? And in 24 days, as I mentioned, he composed The Messiah. And it was very well received as part of a successful season in Dublin. And it's there's that saying, like, you're never, what's the saying about in your own?
Prophet, never in your own country.
Yeah, you're never a prophet in your own country. So by going to Dublin, you know, in London, people were all like taking him for granted. But in Dublin, he was like, oh, this is the big guy from London. And so he had like a fantastic breakout winter there, performing a lot of his other pieces. They loved him. And so Messiah joined this growing catalog of Handel's oratorios. But it was, strangely enough, not especially prominent during his lifetime. So when you look at the lists of performances for the rest of his life that he was presiding over, Messiah was just one of them. And in fact, it wasn't the most popular. Some of these other ones that were more kind of like heroic Old Testament figures that you could identify with more, that had like a more definable storyline, were more popular with the public in London. So after this, he gets into, he mostly, like, that's his mainstay now, is these English oratorios. Prove that it works, he can make money, he can make a living doing this, and people like it. These organ concertos I was talking about became a bigger and bigger thing. He started publishing more as well, and making, being able to make revenue off of the sale of published music. He continued composing music for any major royal event. If there was a victory on the battlefield, if there was a funeral, or if there was a wedding, he was all over it.
When, whose coronation did he do the coronation anthems for?
It was for
one of the
Georges. George II.
George II.
That's right. And then music for the royal fireworks, that was in 1749. This is another one of his, maybe his third most famous piece, one of his more famous instrumental pieces. He composed this for actually the end of the War of Austrian Succession, everyone's favorite war that nobody knows nothing about, right? But it was apparently the smashing success. The English came out well, and then they built a giant fireworks building in a park somewhere, and it didn't go very well. But he composed this music for that, and everyone was happy. But of course, this guy's getting pretty old now for the 18th century. You know, you're in your 60s. It's not doing so well, and he starts to have some financial problems too, because he had been able to only kind of, like I said before, bankroll himself without relying on a lot of patronage from other people. So he had money. He had been really good. He had even invested and had this expensive piece of property. But he still was taking a lot of risks, because he was funding his own work. So the biggest loss was his eyesight, which he lost in 1751-52, and that is the end of his composing career. So he didn't do any more composition after that, because he couldn't notate. He continued performing on the organ, so he was, even without being able to see, he could obviously still play, and so he would keep going, and you know, whenever they would be doing a performance of one of his oratorios or even one of his operas as well, then he would play, and then everyone would be like, oh, that's so sad, because you know, after he's done, he didn't even know which way to face, right, because he couldn't see anymore. And he actually was still heavily involved with supervising all the seasons of his oratorios until just before his death. I mean, the source I saw said a week before his death was the last time he was still doing business until then. He was 74. He made it to 74. He died April 14, 1759. So by contrast, Bach, who was born at basically the same time as him, had died in 1750. And I think Scarlatti too, right? Domenico Scarlatti was also born in 1685. They're like the three amigos of the high Baroque. And I think he also had died in 57, or anyway, he was the last. Handel was the last one. So there you go. That is the story of Handel.
I think.
Yeah. He actually only wrote one other oratorio on a Christian theme, and that was Theodora, who was a virgin martyr. And I read once that he was annoyed because it didn't do very well at its first performance. The other oratorios were all Old Testament. And he attributed the failure to the defection of two major sections of his usual audience. He said the Jews would not come because the subject was Christian, and the ladies would not come because it was virtuous.
Switch microphones now, and how do I just push
that? It's just by tapping the next
tapping? Okay, all right, very good.
Do you need it full screen down here?
No.
Oh my God, I'm glad we don't have to do that.
That's his handwriting.
Well, yeah.
Right?
It's legible.
And so, yeah, well, when he writes it, he writes Messiah, an oratorio. That's how that's the opening page. Now, what I'm gonna try to do, I have too many toys to worry about. This, let's hope this works. This very precarious system here is to see if we can listen to the music. How many of you have brought your own copy? Good for you. So feel free to sing along, even if you don't have your copy, that's okay. We're gonna be playing music. Now, before we do that, I would like to give you just a little bit of context. Mike just told us who Handel was, and now that we open this second section with this idea of Messiah as an oratorio. So let's see what this is, what this means. There you go. So Messiah, as Mike mentioned, was composed in 1741 when Handel was already living in London, and as I said, it's an oratorio that is in English language. And one of the things that is important about this oratorio is that it's not in dramatic form. There's other oratorios of Handel that still have a little bit of that staging that you would see in opera, although not to the same degree of elaborate staging that happens in opera with very lavish costumes, etc. The theme, the Messiah, as many of you already know, this is specifically talking about Jesus as the Messiah, not any Messiah, because in the Jewish tradition, a Messiah, among other things, but primarily we think of a Messiah as an anointing king, anointed king or high priest. And for example, we have here on screen one of the messiahs that Isaiah mentions is Cyrus the Great. So the messiahs were not exclusively Jewish. It's in the case of Cyrus, he's an instrument of the God of Israel. That's why he's anointed Messiah. That's why he's a Messiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus. That's Isaiah 41 and the first verse. Now, in the specific case of today, of the Messiah of Handel, we're talking about Messiah, Jesus as the Messiah. And so in the Christian understanding is that Jesus is the Messiah foretold in the Hebrew Bible. And one of the people who were who really, really was convinced about this understanding was Charles Jennens, who Mike mentioned, who was the librettist of not only Messiah, but many other operas that Handel was composing, and some of them successful. Saul is one of those. Now, Charles Jennens, what did you say he was?
Cantankerous jerk.
Cantankerous jerk, yes. And so because of that, and he was not a very likable character, apparently. The musicologists always don't like him too much, but I think he did a fantastic job at putting this libretto together. And it's, in my opinion, part of the success of Messiah is not only the genius of Handel, but also the work, if not the genius, at least the talent of Jennens, who put together passages from the King James version of the Bible and the Book of Common Prayer. So these were the two main sources of scripture that people were using at churches in England at the time. Not just the Church of England, but other churches in England were using this translation of the Bible, because Christians don't read in general. The vast majority don't read either Hebrew or Greek or Latin, so that's why the translation. And also this special Book of Common Prayer that has, among other things, a psalmer. So it has all the psalms. So whenever you have a psalm in Messiah, it doesn't come from the KJV a version of the Bible. It comes from this common book of prayer from the KJV, King James version of the Bible. He just draws bits and pieces from all over the place. Although you see here more books of the New Testament, actually the bulk of Messiah is Old Testament. And the primary source is Isaiah. Isaiah is one of the favorite prophets for Christians. Like, there's a lot of, as we go through the music, you'll see why there's so much Isaiah. And as I mentioned, this the Psalms all come from this Psalms of David in the Book of Common Prayer. So they're a slightly different version. They sound a little bit more poetic, so maybe that's why Jennings thought it was a better fit. As Mike mentioned, there was a decreasing interest in anything Italian in London, and so that was what the changing situation in terms of musical taste. Now, another thing that we have to remember is just 1 year before Handel composes Messiah, David Hume publishes a treatise on human nature. And I am not the philosopher, but just to summarize what this treatise is, I'm just going to tell you that one of the most important things here that is happening at this time in primarily in England and France, but also in other parts of Europe, is this deist, this enlightenment deism. So, like, the idea of that God's existence can only be proven by reason and observation of nature alone. So that is a direct rejection of divine revelation, divine intervention, and also the miracles that we read about in the Bible. And this has consequences and influences not only in Europe, but also in the United States, where you have someone like Jefferson who goes and just cuts off any mentions of miracles or divine intervention in his personal, I think it's just the New Testament that he went and did this exercise, and that's available. And so you see all these holes in his Bible because he didn't like anything supernatural. So that was the position. Now, Jennings is a very devout Anglican, and he is definitely anti-deist. And because of that, we see so many prophecies, so many prophets, all these in God intervening in human affairs. A little bit more about what was happening at this period in the context of the music. Now, Handel is one of the most known, most celebrated icons of this that we call the Baroque period. That roughly, conveniently, we say goes from 1600 to 1750. 1750 is the death of Johann Sebastian Bach. And so there's a little bit of overlap between what came before the Renaissance period and the classical era of Mozart, Beethoven, for example, Haydn. And so the Baroque period is this roughly 150-year period in between that you have named, some of whom Mike mentioned already, like Vivaldi, Corelli, Scarlatti in Italy, and so many Italians that I could have slides and slides of this. Some of the most famous that also Mike mentioned in Germany, Telemann, Bach, Handel, Pachelbel in France, Lully, Charpentier, Purcell, I forgot to say England there. So England, at least someone was doing something in England in this period, but not as many great composers, at least recognized as the time as great, were in this period, or that we today consider great. I mean, remember, one thing to mention is that how today we see and we acknowledge the genius of composers of the past is not necessarily the same of how people at the time acknowledged those same people. So Bach died, and he was buried in a just small parish cemetery because no one thought at the time that he was important at all. And later on, when people like Mozart, Beethoven start playing what Bach had written decades before, that's only then when people started recognizing the genius of someone like Bach. Now, how many of you, for example, are familiar with the operas of Handel?
A little bit.
Of course you are. But I'm sure that many of you would may have heard like Om Brahmai Fu Divegetabile Karaitamabile. So this is the kind of music that he was really known for in Europe, and for centuries no one bothered to play these operas until, I would say, the late or mid 20th century, when we started to once again look into this Baroque opera style. This is a very important period in the history of music, and is my favorite period. I love Baroque music more than any other kind of music. Some of the most important developments that happen in this period is like the establishment of what we call tonality. Now, I can't play this here, but we're familiar, even today, with this same system that was pretty much developed and acknowledged and by all musicians in Europe. That if you say da na 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 na, that's a major scale. And if you say da na 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 na, that's a minor scale. Now, before this period, you didn't have that. People didn't agree on those things, and so Renaissance music, you have all sorts of alternatives on what note. Remember that we have 7 steps, but we have 12 notes. So which step you go first is going to change how your scale is going to sound. And also how you tune your instruments is going to have a huge change. So when people like in Turkey, for example, people still use different tuning that we use. And if you listen to Turkish music, it's going to be like, oh my God, that sounds weird. That's out of tune, but it's not out of tune. It's just like, it's a different tuning. So the tuning, the tones, and also the styles like opera, concerto, sonata, which simply means something played, cantata, which simply means something sung, and the oratorio that, at least at the beginning, is something that comes to be like an alternative to opera that in Italy you have to play during Lent. So 40 days out of the year, the church didn't like opera. I'm not sure exactly why, but there's a lot of, you know, operas that at least, I don't know if any of you is familiar with Opera Atelier here in Toronto, and they specialize in Baroque opera, and I'm not sure how authentic their stagings are. They try to go back to the original sound, but their staging is kind of provocative, racy even. So maybe because of this or other things or other themes, perhaps the church said only religious topics during Lent. And so this is when composers have to start paying attention to this not so over-the-top opera. And and that's when the oratorio becomes a better developed, better well-formed style. Now, Handel's Messiah is an oratorio composed in the Baroque period by one of the major exponents of this musical style. Now, it has a very, very, very simple orchestration, just like strings, like 5 lines of strings, violin first, second, there's the trumpets, timpani, and the continuo, so either a harpsichord or an organ. There's not a lot of indications exactly about the instruments. That's something that is very common in this period as opposed to later with in the era of Mozart, for example. People started experimenting with sound, almost like using the orchestra as a synthesizer to make a particular sound. We'll hear at the end Mozart's take on Messiah, and hopefully you'll see what I mean by using the orchestra like something like this to make a sound, not just a note. Basic soprano, alto, tenor, and bass choir, so four lines, and then some soloists. And there are many, many revisions by Handel of Messiah. And it has been revised not only by Handel, but also by others, like most notably Mozart. Mozart just wrote his own version of Handel's Messiah. So that has problems for, I would say, like those purist artistic directors in the 20th and 21st century that really want to go for the original sound of Handel, because there's not just one, there's many. And so if you really want to play as Handel would want you to play Messiah, which of the many versions of Handel would you choose? Because he also wrote really for whatever was available at the time and how expensive of a staging that the donor was, or that the company was able to support or spend. If there were like five soloists, then he would write for five soloists. If there were only four or three, he would just make adjustments. If he had a good soprano that would reach higher, then he would reach, like, he would make her go higher. If the soprano or the castrato were not very, you know, like high pitch voice, then he would just make corrections. So if you're a singer today, and if you go to, for example, just a modern edition of Messiah, there's a lot of big notes and then little notes, and at the bottom you'll have alternative ways of singing it. So you have to, it's usually up to your conductor to decide. Now, other things, for example, this is the Christmas Oratorio by Bach, and there's just one. This guy was too busy to write the same thing twice, or I guess his kids were too busy copying new music every week to just rewrite this. This actually is not one oratorio. It's just five or six cantatas put together for Christmas. Okay, well, I think that was enough of a context. I don't know if you have any questions up until this point. May I go in too fast? There you go. All right, finally, Messiah. So how is it structured? So we have, at a big level, a 10,000-mile view, is three parts. The three parts could be really seen as three different oratorios. The first one, I would say, is more like a Christmas oratorio. You have the prophecies of the prophets of Israel, like Isaiah, of the prophecies about the coming of the Messiah. And also, in that first part, you have the nativity scene from the Gospel of Luke. And so all that is like mixed in together to make one single Christmas narrative. The part two, I like to call it the Passion. Now, Bach has, I think he has four, right? Four Passions. I think he wrote one Passion for every Gospel. I was going to bring my favorite, the St. John's Passion. So Bach didn't bother putting Christmas and Easter together. But here we have, in the middle of Messiah, although we usually sing it for Christmas, there's the Passion narrative, including the mankind's rejections and the redemptive sacrifice. And that's when we sing Hallelujah. And finally, part three is a totally different thing. That's more like a theological
treatise about the resurrection of the dead, another important Christian central theological concepts. The text comes primarily from the letters of Paul. So there's not a lot of gospel account. All right, let's see if this works. You have to be ready to regulate the volume, Mike. Okay? So here we start. A little bit more. So this is that movement that this is how we open Messiah, with this movement called the Sinfonia. Janus was complaining that this was too French, that this was not fit of the topic, either of Handel or of the Messiah. And there's this French thing, if you listen to these French composers that I mentioned before, like Lully, there's this da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That's how a French opera would start. So even though he was writing oratorios, he still wanted to do opera. So Janus didn't like that. And notice the tone. What mood does it transmit to you? Either happy or let's make it simple. Happy or sad? Or okay, somber, right? It's okay. Yes. But now, at the end of this movement, see what happens. Same mood. Sun starts shining. So this is very intentional. And so the interpretation is that it tries to put us in the mood of the Judahite exiles in Babylon. And then the prophet Isaiah, in the voice of the tenor, starts telling us this. One of the most famous moments of Messiah.
Comfort ye, my people.
Saith your God, speak you comfortably to Jerusalem and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she hath received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. That's not, that last part is not. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. And so because of this, especially this last verse, of Isaiah, that's Isaiah 40, verse 3. That's when Christians associate this voice that crieth in the wilderness with whom?
John the Baptist.
John the Baptist. Thank you. And now the tenor, and so this is, again, he's using a lot of the same techniques that you have in the opera. This is called a recitative. So you're telling a story. There's a lot of text. It's almost all this text, except this line. But everything else is there. And the tenor has to kind of sing it in this way with very basic accompaniment. And it almost sounds like speaking with music a little bit. That comes all the way back to, goes all the way back to the Middle Ages, to Gregorian chant. That's how you would have read scripture at a big cathedral, so that your voice projects. If I read, comfort ye, my people, said your God, this is a small place, but if it's a big cathedral, the person at the end is not going to hear me, and so I have to say, comfort ye, my people, and then it's going to resonate, it's going to reverberate. Now, then comes my favorite.
Every valley shall be exalted. Shall be
exalted. And notice this. all those many notes, and we're still in the same line, in the first line. Again, this goes back to Gregorian chant. Now, not in scripture reading, but when... This is a little bit more of a... This is called a melisma and in Gregorian chant. And that was used primarily for contemplation, for Christian meditations. You meditate not by reading the whole text of scripture, but just by doing things like a Kyrie, Kyrie, eleison. So a lot of notes with just a tiny bit of text. It's more meditative for Christian contemplation. And so we're using these same techniques that Europe has been developed for so many years now with the genius of Handel. And then this is all part, like the comfort ye every valley and this movement that comes next. One of the most famous ones, glory of the Lord shall be revealed. So this is the first scene. Like musicologists like to group Messiah in scenes, and this scene is considered like the Isaiah's prophecy of salvation, these three movements. After that, we move to another scene. I'm not going to go through all the scenes because otherwise we're never going to get out of here. But scene number three, now we leave the... we'll start with Isaiah. This is still Isaiah, but this is a different scene. This is a... we move to the... here, in my notes. This is the prophecy of the virgin birth. Behold, a virgin shall conceive, and this is the alto now, or sometimes either female or male alto, or a boy, a castrato would sing it.
Behold, a virgin shall conceive, and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel, God with us.
And this scene ends with another very famous movement. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called. And with this very little bit of text, just four lines of text, he makes a long movement with all these melismas again. That our singers are often, that's when we all get behind. No? And then we move finally to the New Testament for the first time. Now, the Christmas oratorio, it opens, I mean it's in German, but it opens with from the beginning. It doesn't go to the prophets. Where is this? Bereichte Diktion? No. Regardless, Bach starts with the New Testament with the account. He's not going to bother with preambles. But here, after all that about the prophets, the first time we actually introduce the story of Jesus. This is supposed to be an
abiding in the field,
angelic voice. Sometimes it's done with a boy, if available, if you have a good boy soprano. So there were shepherds. Oh. Yeah, there were shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over the flock. by night. Not this, but this. This is the Annunciation to the Shepherd in Luke chapter 2. They were so afraid, which is very common. Every time people in the Bible see angels, they get scared for some reason. But
and the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David.
A Savior, which is Christ the Lord, and this scene closes with
And suddenly, there was with the angels a multitude of the heavenly hosts.
And the choir responds. That's enough for the Christmas story. Now, this is like these are the highlights of the first part. There's other good movements, but these are perhaps the most popular ones. We move to part two, and part two, what I call the Passion, usually. So these are the stages of the Passion, and so traditionally, if you're going to write about the Passion of Christ, you are just going to go, like if you're Bach, you're going to go and do the gospel. You have four gospels. You can choose, or you can just do the four gospels, and you can start. And that's the most obvious thing, right? Well, you have this narrative. The narrative of the Passion in I think, correct me, John, if I'm wrong, but I think in most gospels, if not all, is the most extensive part of the gospel. So when we get to the gospel, to the Passion in the gospel, the story gets slower and we get a lot of detail. Now Bach, he starts with the Passion of John. Jesus geht mit seinen Jüngern über den Bach Kidron. So Jesus and his disciples in the valley of the Cedron. That's how he starts, and he just reads John or Mark. That's how he does his Passion. But here, this is very interesting what Genon did. He writes a Passion and he doesn't use the Passion narrative at all. And so he starts with John chapter 1, and this is not Passion, but at least he starts with the New Testament. And notice, once again, go back to the beginning. Go back to the somber and French style over to ta-da. We start over again. It's in the beginning. Somber again. Difference is, now we stay somber. Why? We get, after this movement, all the Lamb of God, we move once again to Isaiah, and this is one of the low points of the whole thing. We start to reach really deep, despised and rejected, rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. So this is from Isaiah chapter 53, and what I have here is one of the many, many, many paintings that was very popular at the time is called The Man of Sorrows, which inspired a lot of art. And Genon's was definitely influenced by this idea of Jesus as the Man of Sorrows that Isaiah talks about. Genon's was not the only. There was one painter we'll get to that was, he was really all about the Man of Sorrows.
Man of Sorrows and of
this movement continues. He gave his back to his mitres, more Man of Sorrows, and then the next movement. We continue in this movement. This move. We can't move forward. We're stuck in this move that we started with. Surely, he hath borne our grief and carried our sorrows. And he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And this is not the end of the Man of Sorrows. This is my favorite sequence of Isaiah, of Messiah. And continues with one of the best counterpoints ever written. Once again, with this tiny piece of text, he makes a whole movement. Everyone says the same. Listen how all the voices are entering and playing with each other. This is a counterpoint style that was one of the things that Baroque composers really knew how to do. And we continue with the Man of Sorrows and with this this Dutch painter that either really liked to hang out with naked Dutch men, or he really liked the Man of Sorrows, or both. Because he wrote a whole series, and he painted a whole series of Man of Sorrows. And now, interestingly, we continue, but unexpectedly, Handel changes the mood. If I find it, okay, here we go. All of a sudden, all we like sheep. Very sunny, very happy kind of thing. Makes you want to dance and everything. It's part of the same sequence, the Man of Sorrows. So it makes me think of we're just like sheep. That's what Janis is trying to say. That's probably what Handel is trying to say. This is a composer. We're like sheep, we don't understand. We're clueless. So that's my interpretation. Why just all of a sudden, in the middle of the sequence, happy music? But it doesn't end happy. It doesn't end happy because it doesn't matter how clueless we are. Oh, I think it's... And the Lord hath laid on him, on the Man of Sorrows, the iniquity of us all. And then... Man of Sorrow is cut off out of the land of the living. The Man of Sorrow dies for the transgressions of the people. The Man of Sorrows, supposedly. Now we move out of Isaiah, but Jennings puts a song in between the narrative of Isaiah to say that the Man of Sorrows goes up on high, but this is not Isaiah. So as you can see, he's fabricating, I would say, a passion narrative out of the Old Testament using Isaiah primarily, but in this case, for example, a psalm, among others. Now, who is this Man of Sorrows? As inspiring it was for Christian painters of this era and for Jennings and for Handel, of course, this comes from Isaiah. This is the Hebrew Bible. It's part of what is called the Servant Songs, which are poems about a certain of Yahweh, says Isaiah, who is called to lead the nations, but is horribly abused by the people of the nations. However, in the end, is rewarded. And so there are many, of course, Christian interpretations like Jenin's. Jenin says, of course this is Jesus, but there's also Jewish interpretations who say this is not Jesus. This could be, for example, Israel itself. There are parts who says, Israel, my servant, and so that's how it is interpreted by many Jewish scholars. And the same thing with this psalm. Thou art gone up on high. But who goes up on high is, well, it's actually, we're not talking even about heaven. We're talking about a mountain here. This is a different translation now. This is a New Revised Standard Version, which is what modern scholars tend to prefer. And this is what we heard is this verse, but in context, this whole section of the psalm says, with mighty chariotry, twice 10,000, thousands upon thousands, the Lord came from Sinai into the holy place. And now it changes, now it's addressing a person. You ascended the high mount, so it's not heaven, it's a mount, leading captives in your train and receiving gifts from the people, even from those who rebel against the Lord God's abiding there. So this is not quite what Jennings wants. Maybe that's why he used the version of the Book of Common Prayer, because it just says gone up on high and doesn't specify high where. Now, finally, after all this, going up and down to descend to the death, the ascension, we finish this part, this second part, with probably one that most of you know already, even in those of you who come from Colombia, who didn't know about that. Who sing with different lyrics, I learned. Where is it? Here. And now, although the Book of Revelation sometimes is considered like the apocalypse end of the world, here is used to celebrate the triumph of God. This is a celebration. And it all comes from the whole text comes from the Book of Revelation. On to the part, and then this part of the last kingdom of this world. Centers with the same theme in a different note. That's enough. That's the end of the Christmas, the Passion part of Messiah. And now we move to the third part, which for many, I find it a little anticlimactic. After the hallelujah, it's like, okay, this is the end, right? No, there's more. There's a whole other part. And this part is actually the theology part, I would like to call it. See if I can find myself here. We talk about Christian theological concepts like the Day of Judgment and the resurrection of the death. And we have a number of really, really famous songs. I know that My Redeemer Liveth is a very famous aria for soprano. That's the only text that comes from the Old Testament in this last part. Now remember, the part one and part two are mostly Old Testament and a little bit of New Testament. Here, with the exception of this, I know that My Redeemer Liveth, that comes from the Book of Job in the Old Testament. Everything else comes from the New Testament, primarily from Corinthians, one of the letters of Paul, the Apostle Paul, since by death Since by man came death, but also the resurrection of the dead, the trumpet shall sound, that's also Corinthians, and so on and so forth. And I'm only going to make you listen just a very, very closing, because once again, we are celebrating here at the end, after this whole theological thesis. Once again, we're celebrating the glory of the Messianic Lamb. So that's not just the glory of the Lamb. Just Genesis is making the case. The Lamb is the Messiah that the prophets of the Bible, of the Old Testament, of the Hebrew Bible, talk about. And that sounds like this. For the most part, this last section has an avenue. Not hallelujah, not like going up, singing out of your lungs with emotion. It's a little bit toned down, but still. Dignified happiness, I would say. And finishes with another of those things that drive singers crazy, this very intricate counterpoint. Blessing and honor. That's a bass. And then the same line again. The soprano. And that's the bass again during this play. That's the alto with the same tune. Now we think the whole choir is now playing with that same thing. So this is something that choral composers really like to do, and Handel was a master of this. Now, we have an understanding, hopefully, of the structure. Now, I think Mike would like to close this lecture today with evaluating a little bit the composer. I'm just going to... Oh, you're going to use that.
Yeah, before we walked out of here, I just wanted to maybe go over a couple of the most salient points here to remember about Handel, the composer. He was market-driven. He would look at what the market would bear. He chased the dollar. He, you know, put everything together and had a good business sense. And in the same way that what Leandro was referring to a little bit earlier, he was willing to adapt his own work continuously just to satisfy whatever the circumstances were. He was practical, same thing, not a purist. So even in this kind of definitive edition of Handel's Messiah that Leandro has, one of the there's like a 12-8 version of one of the arias from a different version and compared to the normal 4-4 version. And if you're not a musician, that may not mean anything, but it's like a totally different feel and change to the same thing that because of... It's in the...
Which one is that?
It's in the... Look at the table of contents.
Mm. He does like... There's,
yeah, Rejoice Greatly, O Daughter.
There's an appendix with alternative ways of singing or playing something.
So...
Just in case.
Handel was fast and reliable. He... not only could compose very quickly, but he actually always kept his word. This is one of the things that made people like him, is that if he said he was going to make an opera for you 2 weeks from now, he'd deliver. He always did that. He was temperamentally inclined to secular music. Like I was saying before, that's one of the ironies of him being so associated with the Messiah, is that he really was mostly interested in secular music and only did religious music when it was required. He was inclined to theatrical works. So, you know, we should remember that even oratorios are somewhat theatrical. And then certainly all of the, you know, he poured his blood, sweat, and tears into opera. And he was not a one-hit wonder. So that's why I think everyone should go out and look up some of the other oratorios, maybe the operas. The oratorios are probably your easiest entree into this, so no?
Opera.
Opera, yeah, he's biased. But but this there was one musicologist who calculated that Handel wrote as much as Bach and Beethoven combined, which is a lot of music, because both of those guys are very prolific. So there's a lot that you haven't heard, and there's a lot of stuff that's just as good as this that we should really be finding out about. And then this is your closing.
I think just a few notes. Thank you. Well, it's almost like echoing what Mike was saying. We have now, when we talk about Messiah itself, not just the composer, it's really at the bottom of this is the libretto, which is very creative, very effective, and even regardless of what the personality of Charles Jennens may have been, he did a fantastic job at really putting together a consistent narrative in a way that was quite unusual. Unlike what Bach was doing, that he was just simply using the narrative that it's already there in front of your eyes. Don't have to just come up with it yourself. Scalability is also a very, very, very important things about Messiah. You can play it with just a handful of instruments, very small choir, but it also sounds good with a larger orchestra or a huge choir, like the choir I sing with here, Toronto Choral Society. There's 150 members. Handel originally didn't write Messiah for that many singers, but still, you can have that many singers, or the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, which I don't know how many singers they have. Yeah, well, 200 or more. Yeah. This it has to do with this versatility of this piece, and it's probably one of, outside the English-speaking world, it's got to be probably the single most famous piece of classical music in English language. And because of all this, it has had the lasting influence that it has, that every Christmas you're going to have as many performances of Messiah everywhere, not just here in Toronto, but all around many parts of the world. And I just wanted, before I let, I'm going to let Mike read.
I'm using double microphone.
I'm going to let Mike read this. But what I was talking about a little bit earlier in terms of this lasting influence, he also had a lot of influence on other composers. So Mozart, I mentioned, rewrote the whole thing for new tastes that have developed. Now, Mozart is considered classical era, so it's not Baroque. This is a new style that starts at this after the 1750, and he grabbed the whole score and he made it sound like this. Bigger orchestra with a lot of, can you hear the wind instruments? They were not there. So a lot of developments and influence even after his death. And I'm gonna, okay, I'm gonna read this. The most excellent musician any age ever produced, whose compositions were a sentimental language rather than mere sounds, and surpassed the power of words in expressing the various passions of the human heart. Who's that?
It was an anonymous epitaph written for him after his death.
Oh, good one.
Sentimental did not mean then
what it means. What is it then? Well, sentimental language.
Of genuine sentiment.
Oh, sorry. When I'm here, I forget that you guys are supposed to use the microphone. So sentimental didn't mean the same thing.
It was a good thing, not a bad thing.
It was sentimental nowadays means phony, artificially pumped up feeling. In this context, it means genuine sentiment, real feeling.
There you go. Thanks for the clarification.
anyone has anything to add, any questions? We do want to hear questions. I'm not sure if there's any comments or questions coming from the online viewers, because Facebook is not cooperating with me, but Rudy has something.
How come we never hear of a Mozart's Messiah? I've never heard of it.
Well, it's not. It's how do you say it in German? Der Messiah, Messiah, Messiah. Okay, so it's in German. So I didn't go through the whole movement, but it's in German. It can also be sung in English because it's the same. But for one of the reasons that it has survived is that it was played throughout different periods of the history of music, because composers were adapting this piece to the new tastes. And so now, I'm not sure when was the last time that it was fashionable to our modern ears to listen to Messiah the way Mozart would have written it. There has been a lot of, how would you describe it, Mike? A lot of rediscovery of the Baroque style. So when I was in music college, that was in the 90s, my professors at the time had probably never learned how to properly play the Baroque style. So maybe because of this, it's something like a Mozart arrangement sounded better to them. But now it sounds kind of strange because we're trying to go back to the original quote-unquote sound. So there's versions online, like that's where I found that. But now it sounds odd to us, but maybe 30, 40 years ago would have sounded just right. That's how it sounds. Even like if you listen to how singers sing right now, the same technique was not the same. If you listen to first recordings in the 20th century, the style, there's a lot of portamento, people sing like, oh, they do a lot of that. That's totally, if you do that, you're not going to get any gigs nowadays as a classical singer, but it was fashionable back then. So it's our ear, our taste in music is constantly changing.
Yeah, and I would add that with Baroque music, it was basically swept under the rug for 200 years after the classical era started in the mid-1700s. And it was really only, and not all the repertoire, but especially the performance practice, like Leandro's referring to. So it's really only in the mid-20th century, especially in the 60s, that people really like realize there's this huge mine of wonderful music that we haven't been paying any attention to. And so that's why it's been coming back. So it's very possible that before, like maybe in the 1920s, people might have still been using the Mozart version of the Messiah because it sounded more like what they were used to back then, because they hadn't heard real Baroque music performed in a real Baroque style for 150 years.
And there's some very important artists right now, singers, like if you're familiar with classical singers, a big name is Cecilia Bartoli, as a mezzo-soprano, and she's one of these artists that in the late 20th century started doing this research on all these Baroque and early classical composers that people had decided are not worth it. These people are no good. No one was for probably centuries playing their music, including a famous one like Salieri. If you saw the Amadeus movie, Salieri, oh, his music is so bad. He's such an awful character. And now there's a lot of musicians that are singing Salieri. So it's hard, right?
Didn't he teach Beethoven? Didn't Salieri teach Beethoven?
Probably, I don't know. But sometimes they didn't get along, teachers and students.
Yeah. No, he was a perfectly competent composer, just not a genius. Well, there is plenty of room in the world for artists who are not geniuses.
There's some pretty cool arias, entertaining arias, but yeah, maybe not everyone is a genius, for sure. All right, it's probably late, so we can probably continue the discussion in the other room. Is that okay? Unless, thank you.